Let's talk about identifying rectangles and triangles in nested loops. When you're trying to identify nested loops, you have to first recognize single loops. In general, these are easy to identify because they're linear. That is, they start at one point and they go to the other without too many interruptions in the middle. Now, there are exceptions to that, binary search being an example of one that's different, but in general, that's going to be true of single loops. Nested loops can be a little bit harder to identify. There are two common patterns that I want you to be familiar with. Now, the names for these are sort of my own creations. They're not something that everybody has thought about and understood, but I think they are two useful categories for you to think about. The first one is what I call rectangular loops, and the second one is triangular. And I'll give you some examples and some explanation to help you identify these yourself. For rectangular loops, each for loop, and I'm saying for loop here because they often are, but they don't have to be. While loops and for loops are completely equivalent. So these loops progress through indices, usually for an array or an array list. The indices of the nested loops are independent. So what I mean is the counting in the outer for loop and the counting in the inner for loop aren't depending on each other. So here's an example of a nested for loop that's a rectangular pattern. So we have int first is 0, first less than 5, plus plus first, and then int second equals 0, second less than 3, plus plus second. And here in the body of the inner loop, all we're doing is printing out a single asterisk. Notice that's a print and not a print line. And then at the end, after the inner for loop is completed, we're doing one new line. So let's think a little bit about what this means. So we start out with first is 0, and we immediately dive into the inner loop. Now this inner loop is just going to repeat three times and is going to print out three asterisks. So that's what the inner loop is doing, is printing out a line of three asterisks. What the outer loop is doing is repeating five times. So what you'll have here is three lines of five asterisks each. So that looks like that. Well, if you think about it, that's what I mean by rectangular. So notice the fact that the outer loop was repeating five times didn't interact with the fact that the inner loop was repeating three times. It just controlled the number of lines. That's what I mean by independent. And that's a rectangular pattern. Now, triangular nested loops are a little bit different. Here, the index of the inner loop depends on the outer one. So let's take a look at an example here. Int first equals 0, first less than 5, plus plus first. So the outer for loop is exactly the same as the one we had before. But look at the difference with the inner for loop. For int second equals first, second less than 5, plus plus second. Now here, second and first are interacting. So that inner loop is starting at a different point in each iteration of the outer loop. The body of the inner loop is the same. We're just printing single asterisks, and when we get all them printed out, we're printing a new line. So if you think about it, the first trip through the inner loop is going to print five asterisks, the second one four, the third one three, and so on. What this means is the pattern of asterisks is going to look like this. So when you see that, that's a triangular pattern, and that's what I mean by a triangular nested loop. So let's take a look at a couple examples and see how these things play out in real methods. The first one I'm going to look at is disjoint. Now, this is an array version of a method that's actually in the collections class. Here's a signature for it, Boolean disjoint, and then we have two arrays, first and second. Now, disjoint is a discrete mathematics term, one you may not be familiar with, and if you're not, don't worry about it. So what it means is that no elements are shared between the first and second arrays. That is when disjoint is true. So for example, if first contained 9157399 and second contained 249, disjoint with these two arguments would be false because they both contain a 9. If on the other hand, first contained the same thing above but second contained 246, at that point the method would return true. None of the integers that are in the second array are also in the first array. Now, one thing you're going to notice here is that I'm implying perfect size arrays. I didn't say that in the description, but you can pick it up from the signature of the method. If these weren't perfect size arrays, we would have to know the size of the first and the size of the second. So you can tell whether there's a perfect size or an oversized array just by looking at the signature of the method if you think it through. So, let's create a plan for figuring out whether we have disjoint or not. What we want to do is step through that second array and look at every element in the first array and see if they're the same. So for example, we'll compare 2 to 9, then we'll compare 2 to 1, then 2 to 5, then 2 to 7. So what I'm doing is marching across that first row of the array. Once that's finished, we go to the second element of second, which is 4, and we compare 4 to 9, then 4 to 1, then 4 to 5, then 4 to 7, and so on throughout the rest of the array. So what we're seeing here is a rectangular pattern. Now let's take a look at what happens when we hit 9. We compare 9 to 9, and all of a sudden we know that these aren't disjoint. So when we know they're not disjoint, we want to quit and get out of there. So we're going to return at that point. So just because it returns at some point doesn't interrupt the pattern structure. So this is definitely a rectangular pattern. Let's take a look at the rectangular code. So our outer for loop is stepping through the first array one element at a time, starting at 0 going to less than first.length. The inner for loop is marching through the second array. So it starts with the index of 0 and then it stops at less than second.length. What we do inside the inner for loop is we check to see if the chosen element in the first array and the chosen element in the second array are equal to each other. If they are, we return false, so that means the method ends. So remember when those two nines hit in the example? That was where it stopped. If we get all the way to the end of both of those loops and we haven't returned false, then we know we didn't encounter anything that was equivalent. In other words, then we know that the two arrays were disjoint and we returned true. So this is a typical rectangular pattern. So let's look at a second example. This one I'm calling elementsUnique. Here's the signature for it, public static boolean, elementsUnique, and here we have just one array. So let's say our tigrid array contained 1, 3, 4, 6, 5, 9, 7, 7. At this point it would return false, and the reason is that there are two sevens in it, so the elements aren't unique. One of the elements was repeated. If, on the other hand, target contained 1, 3, 4, 9, 7, 5, 6, 2, then this method would return true. The reason it would return true is that none of the elements have been repeated. Now, this is also a perfect size array, and once again, you can tell this from the signature, because I didn't tell you how many elements were stored in target. Now, here's a plan for how to calculate this. First, we're going to compare the first element with all of the other elements in the array. So 1 will be compared with 3, 4, 6, 5, 9, and both of the 7s. Since 1 isn't equal to any of those things, we go on and compare the second element, 3, to 4, 6, 5, 9, 7, 7. Notice we didn't need to compare 3 to 1, because we did that comparison in the previous iteration of the loop. And so there's no reason to do it again. So what we have here is clearly a triangular pattern. Now this triangular pattern doesn't stop until the very last iteration. That's when we find that that first 7 and the second 7 are in fact equal to each other, and that's where we return false. So let's take a look at this method now. Public static boolean unique elements. Our outer for loop starts at first index is 0 and stops when first index is less than first.length and increments it. Now the second index does exactly the same thing, except it starts at a different position. It starts at first index plus 1. Now that is really important to notice that we're not starting at first index, because if we compare the array at first index and second index, when they're equal to each other, that's going to be true every time and we won't get the correct answer. So we have to start second index one position higher than the first index. If you were paying attention, you may have noticed that in the table, that we didn't compare 1 to 1 and 3 to 3, for example. Now, if the two elements are equal to each other, we return false, because then the elements aren't unique, and only when we get to the end of the method do we return true. So this is classic triangular code. What makes it triangular is this first index plus 1 being the starting position for second index. The fact that that second index depends on the first one. So let's make some observations. The first thing is when you're dealing with nested loops, you need a plan for discovering the structure of the nested loop. So don't just dive into writing code. The critical step is slowing down your thinking enough so you can figure out how you're doing these operations. We're used to doing these things so fast in our head that you may not be used to really thinking about how exactly you're doing them. So even though you can do them, it's harder to see how they're done. Now, working through a small example slowly helps. I also really do like to draw pictures, and I do that even when I'm not trying to explain things to students, to see the structure of things and to see how they fit together and to figure out how to write the loops. As I said before, what you don't want to do is just hack at code. You don't want to just sit at the terminal and type, and then test and fix. That's actually an extremely inefficient process. The thinking things through beforehand process, drawing a picture, trying to figure out what the right answer is, will save you many, many hours of programming. So keep programming.